My name is Armin Tarzi, the Director of Policy here at the Los Angeles City Ethics Commission. Thank you for everyone for making the time to come out here today. I'm joined by my esteemed colleague, Mark Lowe, who is the Lobbying Program Manager. And in the back there, we have Mr. David Tristan, our Deputy Director, and we have Ms. Heather Holt, the Executive Director of the Ethics Commission. So thank you everyone for coming out. This is the first of three meetings this month on the municipal lobbying ordinance review. We've had three commission meetings so far on the proposals. Two were conceptual based. One last month we had some proposals presented before the commission, and this is now our third interested persons meeting on the municipal lobbying ordinance. Just to kind of give you a rundown, for 18 months we have been working on these proposals. Like I mentioned, we've had interested persons meetings, we've had numerous meetings internally, we've studied numerous case studies and reports and spoken with other jurisdictions, received input from the public in writing, in person, on the phone, and at the commission meetings, and have received guidance from our commissioners as well. So this is part of the process as well. Your input's very important. This meeting, you know, if you haven't gone back to the corner and received the summary, we do have kind of an outline summary of the key proposals. We also have the actual memo report that was presented at the last meeting, and that gives more of a detailed rationale for our proposals. But this meeting, since you already know our rationale and what we're proposing, this meeting is more to hear from you, the public, the regulated community, the interested parties. So, you know, feel free to, this is going to be kind of an informal process, so, you know, feel free to engage with whatever comments you have, whether it's on the proposals, if you're a registered lobbyist or a filer, your experiences filing, things you would like to see changed, things you would like to see modified, or just comments on our proposals. So this meeting is more about you, so, you know, please, we're going to ask a lot of follow-up questions. It's going to be that kind of meeting, that kind of conversation. This again is the first of three meetings this month. So, you know, what our proposals are going to look like, we're not even there yet. This is the beginning of that process, so just keep that in mind. To start off, I just kind of want to open it up and to all of you, you know, what are your general thoughts or concerns on any particular matter within our lobbying laws or our proposals? Feel free to speak up. We don't have that many people, so I don't think crowd control is going to be an issue. So anyone want to start off? Initial thoughts? Heather Wright, Executive Director.
That's right.
Yes.
Could we get everybody to say what
they're
from and where they're from?
Sure. Let's start right here. Work our way through.
Hi, my name is John Hines, and I'm returning to Clayton Walton.
Hi, Emily Gibson, and I'm a lobbying compliance analyst with
Lincoln. Joe Gardarama, Kaufman Legal Group.
I'm Bill Delvat. I'm a registered lobbyist. Like a 12-step program, excuse me. I'm a partner at Armbruster Goldsmith and Delvat for our land use.
Great. My name is Jason Hardy. I'm an ethics officer for the Lake County Metro.
John Howland, I am a lobbyist with our Environmental Associates.
I'm Shane Phillips, I'm with Central City Association.
Adrian Riskin, I live in Los Angeles.
Great. Introduction.
And Brad Hertz of the Sutton Law Firm and with the LA Lobbyist Association.
Great. Just so you know, when this conversation really gets into it, every time you speak, if you can, state your name for our note-taking purposes, and you're going to see me a couple times sit down and awkwardly try to turn my body and take notes while I'm talking to you, so forgive me. So let's start with a general conversation, general initial thoughts on either our proposals or on our lobbying laws. And I'll open the floor to anyone.
I'll start out, John
yes.
Howland, and Associates. I'll start out, and I'll be incendiary in my statements, with the preface that I've been doing lobbying for approximately 15 years for civic organization, and prior to that for 10 years with another lobbying firm, my current employer. Prior to that, I worked in politics, I worked in City Hall, and I worked for the Center for Governmental Studies, which was a think tank that sought to do campaign finance lobbying reform. Had a lot of issues there because I came out of the world of politics, which is very, the practical world is very different from the academic world and the world that you see if you're trying to regulate something without that experience. That said, as I read the changes and what of the interactions that take place in general start from a presumption of guilt of the regulated community. It seems like you guys are doing something that's inherently bad, and we're going to give you a narrow corridor to walk down. And if you step out of line, you know, if you stumble or anything, it is a problem. I've had some interactions over the years with the Ethics Commission that have been resolved fairly, but I mean, these are really minor things. The large issue really shouldn't be how do we continue to regulate and continue to regulate the community that's in compliance, is how do you get people into the system that are not in compliance. And that's really easy to say, it's very difficult to do, but there are people who do a lot of things in this building who are not, who are essentially lobbyists who are not registered as such. And I think that's a bigger issue for transparency than it is to try and get a report out in a few weeks as opposed to 2 months.
This is Heather Cole. Do you have a suggestion for how to do that?
No, I'm going to be an armchair quarterback. It's very difficult. And I'm not really sure how you would do it. Some of them are quite simply, and I'll just go with the obvious targets are, there are some lobby, there are some unions, there are some other 501c3 types and 501c6s that are very active here that are not registered.
Did you know that we have a whistleblower hotline? You can be totally anonymous.
Great.
Yes. I'm Bill Belvac, Congressman Bill Smith in Belvac. I've practiced land use for about 3 decades, including a lot of historic preservation law. I have 3 types of topics: conceptual, fairness, and practical compliance. I trust with all the work you've done that people who have regular business at City Hall and do file try our best to be compliant. There's no point in filing and being non-compliant. And so I think as a matter of practicality, I'm gonna start with the last one and work forward. As a matter of practicality, I was at a meeting today where there were 3 people I did not know, 2 of whom either didn't say their name or mumbled it. Am I supposed to hand them a card and say, please tell me your name, title, and division? I mean, it's just not reality in the way meetings occur. And in my practice, you know, and I did pay attention to the change in the definition for municipal legislation, and I think that's important. I don't know that I agree with all your changes, but my practice is not usually legislative. I'm not saying it isn't ever. Sometimes we do development agreements, sometimes we do specific plans, clearly legislative.
Yeah.
Sure. But many of the things we work on for scores of hours are for quasi-judicial and primarily legal adequacy of environmental review. And I know an environmental lawyer is not your biggest concern, but EIRs take a year and a half. There's probably 50 or 100 meetings or calls. Probably includes, you know, could easily include 50 people at various meetings. To report on a, you know, ongoing basis each and every contact. I bumped into someone from the planning department across the street. I said, you're about to get an email on something. Is that reportable?
No, unless you're getting compensated for it.
I'm getting compensated.
For that contact or for the email?
I'm getting compensated to prepare part of an approval that's being submitted to planning department for their review.
Right.
I was speaking to something that was going to be submitted, is going to be submitted for their review. Is that reportable?
So if, for example, if you are just passing by and you're saying, hey, how's it going? By the way, I'm going to shoot you an email. That seems more, in my mind, seems more of a ministerial act, which wouldn't be under here. But if you are
if that's part of a longer conversation and that's a conversation, for example, you're billing your client, then that's something that would be
wrong. Suppose it's a blank fee though.
Yeah, well, let me ask you this question, because you just to go back a little bit. So you had this meeting today, or
these recently. Are two different topics.
Yeah, yeah. So let's go back forward again.
I have two other meetings at City Hall again today, so.
So just so I can understand your practice, or how you know you would do things, when you schedule those meetings, do you kind of usually pick who you're meeting with? Do you know the title? I mean, how does your scheduling work? Do you always, is it a common practice where you don't know who you're meeting with, or?
Yes, that's a great question, because it takes all forms. Sometimes meetings are requested by clients and their teams. Sometimes meetings are requested by staff of agencies. In my practice area, primarily planning, but not uniquely. And then sometimes meetings are requested by council offices, where they can be in the meeting. But it is not uncommon to show up in a meeting with people I didn't know were there, who would be there. And I think it must happen to you too, if you think about it, right? Do you get everyone's name? Are you supposed to pass a roster? I mean, by the way, if this is the rule, you should require city officials who host meetings to pass a roster and provide it to every person. Because honestly, to leave the burden on the filers, unless you're going to do that, and I'm not urging you to do that, because I don't know why that's balancing practicality and disclosure, but if it's really going to be every contact, there needs to be some steps the city takes to facilitate the reputation of that. And I don't want to dominate. I really do appreciate the opportunity for dialogue. I wish we did more of these things. I do question why working on quasi-judicial matters, giving legal advice, adequacy of environmental impact, preparation for my client to win litigation. You know, are city staff involved in listening? Sure, of course. Are they city attorneys there sometimes? There's scores of hours that get recorded by lawyers for doing legal work because it's on things that would meet the definition of city matters. So I'd ask for some consideration about that. You know, when you look at who ends up in colleague from a former law firm of mine is here. The land use law firms have big recordings, not because we're calling council members all the time, but because we're working on legal submissions. So I'd ask about that. Fairness, there's a huge unfair gap in the law, and I want to give a specific to John's point about people unregistered. Many land use opponents hire attorneys who work for free until they file lawsuits, and then they collect legal fees. They write letters, they appear, they go to council meetings, they contact staff. They don't get paid until after the approval. They never register. I could probably give you, well, you could ask the city attorney who the most active litigants against the city are. I'll bet you none of them are registered.
There's no promise of any compensation at that, like at any point?
I don't know what their engagement letter says. The engagement letter says, you know, if we collect attorney's fees, you'll get it. It probably does. But even if it doesn't, it's a plan to do it that way. It isn't accidental. Almost nothing gets settled without legal fees being paid. Almost nothing. So today was Cultural Heritage Planning Commission. Just go sit on Planning Commission and see which lawyers are there for a project. I mean, I'm telling you, there's a huge volume of contacts that are undisclosed and lobbyists are not registered because of the quirk of you only register when you get paid. If you don't get paid for a year and a half, and you've done a year and a half work, where's the registration? And by the way, to your point, I have had clients file complaints and no actions ever been taken against these lawyers who appear at those files.
Perhaps public action.
Understood. Yeah. Let me be more clear. I am not aware of it. And I haven't seen those people end up getting registered. So, anyway, I appreciate you listening.
Sure. Yes.
Brad Hertz, on the issue that Mr. Delvac brought up, we think there's it's different enough, the kind of activities that property owners are involved in, that it may warrant even its own interested persons meeting. Like, I know you're having one for nonprofits. You know, there's different kinds of contacts, a lot of administrative, ministerial, but then also some discretionary lobbying. But I think it's just very different from someone who's trying to have an ordinance be passed by the city council. And we think the exemptions should be different. Some of the definitions should be different. I think the executive director in the past had agreed that kind of land use lobbying and advocacy is a different animal from some of the more traditional lobbying that we think of. So we just think it should be looked at separately and analyzed separately.
Just to clarify, I don't think that I can make that distinction.
You do, or you have to?
I don't think I have.
Okay. It may, someone from staff over time may have suggested that the different exemptions, different definitions may apply or may not apply to the land use agreement based on the entitlement process. Sorry if I ascribed anything to you.
You mentioned other exemption comments you had and on definitions. What are those?
I don't have specifics in mind for today, but I think those who practice in the land use area would have more specifics of, you know, why am I being brought in lumped in with the more traditional kind of lobbyists when all I'm doing is, you know, a zoning variance or whatever other specialized things land use attorneys engage in.
And, you know, we did meet as a staff. There were several of us who met. There were two high ranking folks in the planning department, and we asked them, we said, is there a bright line that you can tell us? Like, if it's up to point X, then it's never going to be lobbying, and there's no discretion involved on the city staff's part. And then after X, you really got to think about having people register, and they were not able to do that. What they told us was that there is discretion that can be exercised at every step of the process, even when it's still at the counter stage. We were trying to get them to help us along those lines and say, please, is there a bright line? We would love to be able to make an appropriate distinction, and the staff here were not able to do that. We're not able to say definitively that there is a point at which no lobbying occurs. So I don't know if you have a thought about that. Or do you?
I don't at this okay. point, but okay. I think there is a methodology, I believe, that can be worked out that would include the information that's really relevant and important to people as far as the law being complied with, but not be overzealous in terms of collecting information about every meeting, every contact, et cetera.
I have a thought, if I may.
Yes,
please. You know, the question is the lens what the action is or what you're doing about that action? Because, for example, a variance is a discretionary action. It requires CEQA compliance. It's going to have a decision made. Now, I didn't ever think that's what municipal legislation meant, that you're changing the law to say, well, no, it's a city matter. Okay, so fine. That's a city matter. It's discretion. The city has the right to say yes or no. But there are many steps in that I think if, and you know, I think it would be incumbent upon us to help try to provide our thinking. We do this every day, you know. There are steps in that really probably should be considered. They're really just about the compliance, filling out the application. Well, there was something in the old law. But filling out an application, giving my own client advice is that you know, and I do see exclusion for litigation or some proceedings, but I need to work that time. But I think there are aspects of matters that you're defining the city matters that the component of which
yeah, and we don't want to loop those in. I mean, there are all sorts of proposed exemptions to the definition of direct contact that are designed to specifically address that. And that's what we were trying to get at with the planning staff. Like, please tell us. Because if, you know, filing an application, that does seem like nothing but a ministerial act. But at least the staff that we spoke with, they were unable to say that there is nothing at the counter stage that is entirely always ministerial.
So what about advising my client, their consultant, maybe even the city, as to our view of legal adequacy of CEQA compliance? You know, the single biggest risk to the city is losing CEQA litigation. It's the way in which people try to stop projects. It's the way in which community groups exact money or get resolutions. It's the way in which these unregistered lobbyists get paid late. You know, is a year and a half of work on legal advocacy of something that you don't spend on litigation? Is that really what you're trying to regulate?
Yeah, Armin, can you read what the proposed exemption is for the attorney?
Well, it says, and just by the way, this is excellent, and I will admit, I'm just catching up to it. Is it on page, are you referring to page 307 on attachment A, number 9, providing legal representation for a party in litigation or an enforcement proceeding?
Yes.
But for me, I was not enforcement.
Is that
providing legal representation?
Not litigation?
It's not, it's making sure you're going to win litigation. No one's in litigation. I said it to try to be funny, but honestly, this is really what clients spend hundreds of thousands of dollars with law firms is getting ready to win litigation.
Right. Well, if you were amending that exemption to address this issue, how would you make it read?
I'd like to get this brought, because obviously you guys did, and you. Mm-hmm. And I, by the way, I will say, and I just to prove I'm an attorney, I'll sound like I'm arguing against myself. I do think there's a benefit in simplicity and clarity. 12 rules are harder to deal with than one rule. So, but let me give some thought.
Okay.
What's the time frame for giving meaningful input?
I would say at least 3 or 4 days, at the very least, to be included in the comments before the meeting. But the earlier the better, because the earlier we receive it, the more, you know, discussions we can have about how we can incorporate public comments. Like that. So,
what's the next step in this process? You're going.
We're also going to have a meeting this Saturday, and we're also having a meeting next Wednesday as well. So
and then it goes to the commission.
Then staff is going to deliberate, and we're going to, you know, I hope.
Okay.
Yeah,
so it's not going
we might even reach out. Yeah, we might even reach out to.
Okay.
You
know.
The next commission meeting is October 17th.
Okay.
But if comments that the staff receives in the next 2 to 3 weeks would be most helpful in terms of shaping.
Understood. I don't want to do you what our opponents do to us all the time, which is show up at the last meeting and dump 150 letters.
Thank you.
Right. Yes, I appreciate it.
Which is why we spend all that money being ready.
A scenario that,
yes.
Let me give you a hypothetical that's very similar to something I experienced in a previous position. It goes along with what, sort of with what Bill is saying. Let's say, and this could change some of the details, but I'm representing a land use project. I am not an attorney, and I bill on a flat monthly. I bill on a flat monthly fee. It's a contentious project. A council member asks that I come in and I bring my client to discuss this with the local HOA. There's also another group involved in this that's some sort of a 501c3 or 6, an environmental group, and maybe even for some reason there's a involved in this. We get together, the council member is there with two members of his or her staff. Under the way it's been suggested, that counts. I am required now, as a lobbyist, to put this down as I met as a meeting, as a contact with the three city officials. Maybe there's one or two people complaining too. Doesn't really matter. The people across the table, the homeowners association, they could potentially benefit as well, potentially financially, from a decision that comes out of this. The environmental group, there's a settlement, could benefit on Bill's lines, and the union, their employees, many their members, several of whom are there. I must mention this. People who are there on behalf of, you know, who are there under the environmental group, they're probably paid, and other folks, but I'm the only one that has to put contact down. We're all there, we're all lobbying, we're all trying to fight on the same issue, just on different sides of it. However, under the regulations, I'm the only one that has to be registered, and I'm the only one that has to note this. Not really, that's the transparency that I was talking about. It doesn't really give the average person who's not directly involved in this, it doesn't give them a full idea of what's going on. In fact, it makes it look like, you know, my client has paid me all this money to lobby on behalf of my client, but it doesn't show that there's a well-organized group going the other way. Again, it's an idea. I don't have an idea except to say that, you know, if you have organized groups, perhaps there should be a way of doing that. If the idea here is disclosure and transparency, and giving as much information as possible to the public, then they should have the full details and not half information.
And that's also the assumption that they meet the threshold, right?
Well, no, I'm saying that this is the issue with the threshold is homeowners associations charge dues. These outside groups either have dues payers or they get subsidized by donations and contributions. So they're not wholly, you know, they're not just these people. There are some finances involved, and some of them are paid in some cases to be there. And some of them pay people to organize others to go there in a very concerted effort. And in some cases, they may even help to bring those people in. None of that is being disclosed.
Are you saying that you would prefer to have no threshold?
I'm saying that the threshold is very arbitrary, and it allows a lot of groups who are very active in lobbying, and perhaps not the legal definition that you have here, but in what would be a more generally agreed upon idea of what lobbying is, to go to skirt, need to register and disclose what they do.
Yeah. We are completely aware of that. And our goal really is to make this as fair a system as it can be.
Yeah.
And so we don't include in our current law, and we haven't proposed a number of the exemptions that exist in other jurisdictions, because we do think it's fair. If we're going to say that the public has a right to know who's attempting to influence how their dollars are spent, mm-hmm. then it should apply to anybody who's engaged with a certain level of activity. So it's finding that balance can be difficult, but we completely hear you.
Yes.
I just wanted to bring up the issue of lobbyist employers versus lobbying firms, and I think that's something it's not really addressed in the current ordinance very well. There's not really a distinction. And I think, you know, listening to you just talking a moment ago about, well, were you paid for that engagement? And that came up at the last committee or commission meeting as well. In my case, I'm not paid directly by any client. We have members and we advocate for things, sometimes projects, sometimes legislative, but those are not, and sometimes they're not even with the guidance of membership. Sometimes it's just a staff decision that this is the direction we want to go. And so I think, you know, bringing in those requirements based on compensation complicates that a lot. And to some extent, it's a threshold that we're kind of at the same time crossing, but never actually touching. We're like on a parallel track almost. And I think there needs to be just in general more of an appreciation that there are different kinds of employment amongst lobbyists, and that any rules that are created need to recognize those differences.
For your particular organization, what would you view as kind of the best approach?
Off the top of my head, I don't want to give a, you know, off the cuff answer.
I'm Mark Lowe, I'm the lobbying program manager. I just want to be clear about the structure of your situation. Is it a membership organization? You said that pays dues and events for, and you work for that organization, and you might be coming before the city and talking to officials that would ultimately benefit not your parent organization that you work for, but the membership people itself or membership groups? Am I right in that?
Correct.
Okay. So the interests that you're representing are not really the person who signs your paycheck, that organization. The people who receive the benefit of your activities of coming before the city and communicating would be those membership organizations. Because a structure like that.
It is the members.
The members. That actually sounds like those members are individual clients.
And you know, perhaps that's how it's defined, but on especially on legislative matters, we are not working on behalf of a specific member in most cases, if that's clear. I mean, if you're talking about a real estate development project where you have a lead, you know, a law firm that is there advocating for a specific project, it's a very clear relationship, a one-to-one relationship. And I think when you're not being, you know, contracted per se for specific lobbying activities, then it's just a different relationship. And again, I think there's just not really much of a recognition of that.
Sure, and I'm trying to get a better picture of that for us so that mm-hmm. we can address that type of thing. So is it a more of a policy matters that you would be coming before the city that would benefit your members as a whole type of thing? To make that distinction between such as development matters. Is that what we're talking about?
I'm John Howland. I had his job before him. For example, I came and I testified on numerous occasions, and this was in my reports, for the ad hoc committee on job creation for the city. There was nothing that was specifically benefit any one individual member there. This was, we thought, to help to improve job, create more jobs, stimulate the economy, bring more businesses in that would create a better economy for the situation, which would benefit our members as well as a lot of non-members. I think that might be an example.
And if I'm correct, this was with CCA?
It was with CCA.
Right, so CCA is an organization that whose purpose was to, in fact, come to the city and, or one of them, excuse me, right. One of your jobs would be to come to the city and lobby on behalf of general policy right. that would affect legislation that would affect all these people,
right.
correct? So in that respect, that's why you were required to register as a lobbyist with a lobbyist employer, which
right.
is
one
yeah,
of the no one here is arguing that we should not be registered as lobbyists. We're just saying that, you know, for example, in the case of this proposed ordinance update, there were requirements and, you know, this discussion we were having about what counts as a lobbying contact, the threshold that was just suggested here is one that is kind of meaningless from my perspective, because there is no specific compensation for, do you understand where I'm coming from? Like, I'm not paid by the hour by a client to advocate on a specific subject.
Correct. Yes,
so setting requirements that are based on that kind of leaves us in the lurch, and we don't know where to go with that. And my broader point is that it seems that that thinking and those rules are being proposed because there is a lack of consideration for the difference between lobbyist employers versus lobbying firms.
I appreciate that. You know, lobbying is done by individuals on behalf of whether it be their clients or their employers. Mm-hmm. People that work for lobbying firms, you know, yes, they go out and they lobby and their firm is paid by their clients. With regard to a lobbyist employer, that is not the case. We've understood that from when we first came up with that term. However, as a person who is compensated to do your job, you do receive some sort of salary. And I realize that you may not be engaged in just coming before the city, you do many things, obviously. But you can account for the time that you come to the city or the amount of effort you work that is connected to city matters. And that's customarily or traditionally
right.
the way we've
and that's something that we do now. And again, right. I'm not trying to argue that we should report less than we do by any means. I'm just kind of building on the previous conversation where we're talking about when you're trying to list individual contacts, you're kind of, I think there was a quote from, someone mentioned it at the last meeting, where if you have to think about whether you can do it, it's potentially chilling. So if you have to think about whether I need to list this contact, maybe I'll just avoid it to begin with, which is kind of contrary to the idea of lobbying being a protected and legal activity. I think that's kind of where we're coming from, and really just all I'm trying to say is that we just want to make sure that there is an appreciation for that, and that obviously this is not fully baked yet, but as it moves forward, we just hope that there is that appreciation that if you set those thresholds in a certain way, it will make it very unclear for one group versus another, potentially, what they need to, what qualifies as a contact. And I fully understand and appreciate that you're not quite there yet where you have those specific guidelines, but whatever they happen to be, we're just asking for that consideration.
This is David with the Ethics Commission. In the scenario with CCA, are there situations where, you know, where you describe where you go before a council or committee meetings and take a particular position where in fact it is supporting some of the members in your membership while also opposing the views of some of the members? Did those situations come up for you? Where if you're supporting, you know, X project or issue or matter, some of your membership is going to be happy with that, but others will be upset because they don't feel like that's the position you should have taken.
Yeah, I think that can happen.
There are instances where there's not 100% consensus on something.
Brad Hertz, and we had mentioned this, I believe, in earlier correspondence, but when looking at the threshold for filing, if it's a monetary compensation test as opposed to a contacts test, that ends up having an unfair aspect. And as we've talked about, the highly compensated employee, the CEO, is going to get to that $5,000 threshold a lot more quickly than the lower paid employee, regardless of, you know, how much time they're spending. So we think other jurisdictions are looking at contacts as opposed to compensation or some joint compensation and contacts test. And we just think in terms of trying to get a fair rule across the board, looking solely at compensation is a concern because of that lack of equity and parity.
So are you saying, just to clarify, that there should be kind of a zero threshold, or there should be kind of a split depending on the type of entity, whether it's contact or compensation?
I think either one could work. I mean, I know like LA County, we have the MTA, and that's a compensation, or that's a contacts test, 5 contacts in a 3-month period. LA County, the same. And then other cities, San Diego and San Francisco, which apparently studied what the best measure was of lobbying and having to report, and they chose number of contacts as opposed to salary. San Francisco, I think it's 5 contacts in a 1-month period. San Diego, 10 contacts in a 60-day period. I don't know that kind of blending or having some hybrid of compensation and contacts might not work, it might, but to just have it be compensation, it really doesn't capture, I think, the level of interaction between the lobbyist and the city official or employee.
Do you all have a thought as to what you think the thresholds should be, both for the traditional type of lobbyists and for the in-house lobbyists?
I don't think we've come up with that kind of magic number yet. I think it's more looking at it systemically that we're troubled by the sole task being compensation.
Does anybody else have an idea of what they think the appropriate threshold is? It's okay if you have it.
Well, I think single contact, you know, and I haven't studied your proposal, but again, if I'm in someone at an event and I talk about something that I'm getting paid for now. By the way, is the test when it is money, is it money for the matter or money for that contact? The money for that contact is $50. The money for the matter is $50,000. I'll tell you, we conservatively think it's about the matter, not about the contact.
First of all, Bill, I did want to say thank you very much for coming, and I very much appreciate you. You said anybody who is reporting, you know, is striving to be compliant, and I do think that's true of many of you who I know by name and not necessarily face, so thank you for coming. And I've worked with Laura a lot.
She speaks so highly when she calls and asks us questions. We do want to get it right.
Yes.
And you're there to help.
And she's great. She's great. She's very conscientious, and I know that she's got the company's interests at her heart, and I really appreciate working with her because she's so compliant. I'm willing to be compliant, so I really do appreciate that. As I think, you know, is your thought, you know, it is related to the matter, because there's a lot of communications that might be associated with the compensation you received. So we also have, what are you getting paid for this particular matter? You know, and that's what we look at.
Fair or unfair about life, lawyers get to the higher compensation dollars sooner than anyone else. I mean, the amount of lawyering time and fees exaggerates the effort. When we see our reports, I look at them and say, you know, that's working on an AIR for a year. That's not talking to the city council offices. So.
And when you work on an EIR, who are you engaging with over the course of that year?
It's a great question. So most of the interaction is between a consultant who is paid for by the developer, but really works for the city, in fact. And agree whether they register. I don't know that they do. And they have contacts all the time. So most of the work is that. So typically for us, is we're sitting in our office, and my colleagues from my office, we're sitting in our office reading hundreds of pages of an environmental review document. Is that a city matter? I mean, that's thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. I think it grotesquely overstates. Now, we try to be conservative, and you know, the advice we've gotten to my law firms, to the people who advise me up here. We've tried to be conservative. The advice we've gotten is conservatively things like that probably were covered by the ordinance. And so, you know, so I just think that if the goal is to let the public know who has a big project that costs a lot, because they're doing it for everything. If the goal is to report to the public who's spending a lot of time talking to the city, I don't think what you're doing. But we'll follow the law.
If I may, first I want to acknowledge Commissioner Orton, our ethics commissioner, has joined us. So I want to acknowledge her. And also, a lot of the topics we have talked about were some of the issues that our commissioners wanted us to reassess and also to come back with more feedback on. One issue that we haven't touched on yet was the move towards a more frequent filing frequency, going from quarterly to bi-monthly, along with the deadline to 10 days. So I wanted to kind of get your feedback on those two issues. Yes?
Yeah, so John Hines, Leighton & Watkins. I think that, like the rest of us here, we're very concerned about getting this right. And I think the 10 days makes that challenging. It's just the nature of, you know, a law firm like ours that we're working with both for clients, both in the lobbying capacity and purely legal capacity, or matters related to the city, like you were saying, Mr. Logan, you have to break that out. And part of breaking that out, in order to make sure we get it right and get the city the most correct, accurate information, it takes time. We have quality control checks and the like, and when you're dealing with a number of different clients, it's just 10 days, it's just not practical to get it done.
What do you think would be a more practical time
frame? You know, I think in the 30 days range. I mean, we're not, again, it's not trying to extend this out, but it's, there has to be some protocols. I'll let Emily, if she thinks differently, because she has to do it. But it's getting folks like us to make sure that, you know, it's properly coded and the like, and that there's someone who can oversee to make sure it's done correctly. So, you know, 30 days, 45 days will, again, it's not that much additional time, but it's going to help make sure that the information that the city is giving is the most accurate we can make.
And as part of the changes that we'll be doing, we're going to be looking at changing some of the aspects of our electronic filing system to hopefully alleviate some of the, you know, re-entry of data or information. But maybe you can speak to the time frame, but also things that might make changes to our system easier for you to do that work in a quicker and easier way.
Yeah, and I think we can, you know, it's something we'll definitely look at. I mean, I think Pat Michelle from our shop has been doing this a long time, and he's on vacation right now, which is why he's not here. But we're happy to, you know, work with the city and try to offer some suggestions on how that can work. But, you know, like I said, we really appreciate it.
A question for you guys, actually, on this subject. I feel like it would be helpful for us maybe to understand, you know, how you imagine that the public or maybe you yourselves are using this information, and in what way getting it, you know, 15 or 20 days faster helps. What problem is that solving?
Well, I'll speak to the second part of the question. The way things are right now, and I mentioned this in our commission, the way things are right now, you can potentially have activity that occurs, you know, let's say in the beginning of October, that won't be reported until the January of the following year, January of 2018. And in that process, while there are, and we talked about some of the longer range issues that could take 6 months, a year and a half to resolve, we can, under the current process, you can have legislative matters, especially administrative matters, resolve, start and resolve within that time frame without the public not having a chance to see what's going on, because 4 months have passed since that action has.
So I guess my question though is, where is the benefit to the public? Like, why is it that, I guess, who in the public to some extent is basing how they follow policy or administrative matters in the city on lobbying reports rather than the issue itself, if that makes sense. I understand the way you're framing it, and it sounds like a problem, but I'm not really seeing how it would change anyone's behavior, because if the lobbyists that are making these reports are complying with the law and they are doing things legally, then I'm not sure how having those reports out changes anyone's behavior,
sure.
Yours or you know, just members of the public.
That was one of my questions at the last hearing. I mean, because to me it sounded as if, I don't think it needs, and you're going to have to answer the question because I'm still in questioning mode too, but it sounded to me as if probably not so significant for the staff was looking backwards to see if things have been done appropriately, and but for projects, fast-moving projects, not the EIR that you've been spending thousands of pages on, but fast-moving projects, there seem to be advocates on both sides and entities on both sides, and I guess I think that if I were in one side or the other or entities, I would be using this as a tool to see what kinds of activities were going on from my opponent. And so I think for the public, more so than for the staff, that knowing that significant amount of activity is going on is helpful to the whole group of public that's interested in what's going on. And everything's over by the time they finally find out that, oh my goodness, we have had 14 contacts in two offices, and you know, maybe I should have known that, but it's a little hard to figure that out. And so what I do is I go to the city ethics website to see.
I think that's a fair response, and I understand that. It just feels like, for one, it seems a little improper maybe to put that responsibility on lobbyists for some reason, and also it's a little bit one-sided, where we don't get that same benefit in reverse. And you know, even beyond that, I think it's, I guess if you're so engaged that you're the type of person that's reviewing lobbying reports as they come out, I can't imagine that you're the type of person that has trouble following what's, you know, kind of being actively engaged on it, that, you know, these things are all, they show up on committee, you know, agendas and city council agendas. There are many places that these are advertised, and I struggle to see like really what the lobbying reports are adding in that respect. Obviously they have a lot of value in terms of ensuring compliance and various other things, but in terms of notifying the public of what is kind of
going on,
hot and new right now, like it just doesn't seem like that is or should be their purpose to me.
Yes.
At the risk of getting kicked out of CCA, if you don't tell my partners, I think rapid reporting is a great trade-off of sharing the information and the burden. Laura will be unhappy I said this, but the difference between the 504 reports a year or 6 reports a year is de minimis. That's not the type of burden that troubles me. The type of burden that troubles me is, do I remember every name in a meeting? That's the one I worry about, because I don't. And I gave an example earlier. There were two people in a meeting who didn't say their name. So that troubles me more. Frankly, I do think members of the public look at those. I look at those. One of the things you guys, forgive me saying you guys, honorable staff, one of the things you may be aware of is, given how slowly clients pay, the lag is often more than one quarter. It's when you receive the compensation. And so there's a mismatch on the occurrence of the activity and someone finding out about it by the nature of the compensation thing. Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's my place to endorse, but if you're asking me what troubles me, 6 reports a year doesn't trouble me.
And I did have 19 years in one of those big firms, and
a quite distinguished career.
and I think I said in the public meeting, I mean, that timekeeping was probably my least favorite thing in the world. But it certainly was improved, both in terms of accuracy and my anguish, if I was doing it every day the way I was supposed to,
right.
and filing things faster and faster.
So to go to what the commissioner was saying about public right to know, back to my previous point, where if I'm going to meetings on an issue and I'm followed, or maybe I follow or am followed by someone from a social justice group on the other side of that issue, I'm reporting, the public knows this, because for whatever reasons they either don't believe or they don't hit that necessary threshold to be considered either a lobbying firm, which they're not, or working for a lobbyist employer, it looks again like here's this big, bad, whatever they are, trying to do this, and we're going with no one doing other stuff. So, you know, again, it's whether it's, if it's purely on a compensation model, maybe that's why they don't do it. If they do it based on a contact model, then I think it should get a lot of these groups. And there's a group who has since registered, who one of their lead people said, well, I'm not out there lobbying for these greedy developers, we're not lobbyists. But they're doing exactly the same thing I am, except they're paid indirectly and I'm paid directly. That's, in a lot of cases, the only difference. And so you're not getting a full understanding of what exactly is happening.
John, I'm sorry, you're saying they're being paid indirectly?
Well, some of these 503s are not, you know, they don't have a specific client. It's not unlike CCA. They're paid either through membership dues, through contributions from either individuals, foundations, what have you. They are, by every, you know, common idea of what a lobbyist is or lobbying is, they're doing the same things. They're just, for various reasons, either don't believe they need to register or don't have to.
Now, these parties who are doing the paying, the indirect payments to these people.
And I'm using that as a broad,
sure,
term.
You know, we have modified what we call right now major filers, whereby it would be money that's being expended in connection with attempts to influence, whether that's, and there doesn't even need to be an actual person to be doing that on the ground. So those organizations that you're talking about that might be indirectly doing the compensation might fall under that, because, you know, we're talking very loosely here. I'm not sure if they actually would in the case you're speaking of, but we are trying to address some of those situations. And I do want to address everybody here that I don't want you to think that we just thought that these proposals were the way to go and there was no discussion, because actually, believe it or not, maybe can't tell from this discussion today, but I am the one who champions on behalf of the regulated community the most. I am the one that goes in and says, I work with these people every day. They are the ones calling me, like Laura or Pat or Emily, and they are the ones who have the questions. And I say, these are the things that these people come up with every day, and these are their issues that they have. And we do have a discussion, you know, and it is a good discussion. It's not just me, but everybody does try to bring what they think is the best possible recommendations. And that's why it's so important for you people to be here today. So feel free to come out.
I was up in my for a while. You were incredibly helpful several years ago.
Yeah, I remember.
Really good. I really appreciated that. As a general rule to kind of get off my previous point, those of us who are regulated, if it comes down to, is this something I need to report or isn't it, I'm always going to err on the side of maybe it's something I don't need to report and I'm going to report it, which isn't to say that there haven't been things that I may have forgotten, but it's been my intent and just about everybody I know, it's their intent to report as much as possible. I think if you get into reporting every contact, the filing system and whoever's doing this will be overwhelmed with data. Because in between bills, he was in a meeting with 10 people, and so he's going to put all of that. But I mean, if I'm thinking, did I make a contact? I left a message on someone's phone. They didn't call me back. I called them the second time. I sent an email. I called the third time. This goes on. Maybe there are 10 contacts until I get a response. Do I note the response? Do I note those 10 other times? I'm not really sure. I'm going to put each and every one of them down just to make sure that I'm not in violation. I think that's a problem with contacts going on and having to list everything.
Sure.
And with everyone, and what happens if I didn't get his or her title right? Do I put down that they're a council deputy for council member so-and-so? Do I need to put down that they're council deputy 6, council deputy 4? And there's a lot of think there's a lot of areas for people who want to find errors. If you get into that level of detail, that there's a lot there that they can, and all of a sudden you're, you know, are you in violation? But it's something along those lines.
So John, the current law now, as you know, that each quarter you need to report on behalf of which clients you reached out to certain agencies, and that's basically it. During the quarter, you went to, let's say, planning on behalf of these particular firms.
Yes.
Do you think that's sufficient, or that serves the purpose of you know,
reading the summary here? I think that within a large department, it makes sense to. It's not burdensome to say that you met with people within various divisions of departments about a matter. If you even want to get into the specifics of the matter, whether it's bills, EIR, or whether it's a development agreement or something along those aspects of the larger client. I'm not a lawyer, so I don't work for a law firm, so it's very easy for me to put that on bill. But again, I was in a meeting with 5 people. The client I recently started working for, the others all, I'm sorry, 5 city people, 2 of my clients, and with Bill, everybody else in the room knew each other. I only knew 2 of the city people, and so they just started the meeting and there were no introductions. I figured out who the other 2 were, but it becomes, with that, it's on a much larger scale, it becomes very difficult. And there's not the attempt to hide that, you know, we're meeting with people. It's the opposite. It's like I said, I think you're gonna spend extra time in trying to find out who these people are, and it's gonna lead to, or I'm not sure, it could have been this person or that person. I'll put them both down. I'm not sure. So it's almost, I'm gonna err on the side of too much information on this.
Perhaps if not the name, you probably could name the section or division of the department.
If you met with Lala, met with the people in their commercial real estate division at, LAPD, it was somebody in their, something else division, right? I think, if you don't have to get too granular, it makes it, as opposed to this person was in this section, it was in this section.
Right, because at least if you could give us the division, it would be maybe not the particular individual, but that gives a little bit more specific information.
I think I may regret it, but I think that's doable. I mean, for information, yeah.
Let me ask a quick question. Yeah.
Can I ask a question along that line?
Yeah.
Is it possible that the reason that meetings might be started without introductions, we might not know some of the people who are in the meeting, is partly because we don't require that information to be recorded now? So if we did add that requirement, could it be possible that it becomes part of the city culture because we have these lobbying reports and we do want to enable lobbyists to report accurately, that everybody just kind of understands that we've got to say who's in the room because there are reporting requirements?
I would offer that the reason why people don't introduce themselves to poor manners.
That too.
I wish I was joking.
No,
I
can't.
Let me ask.
But I want to speak to that because, and I don't mean this facetiously, the lack of civility in discussion. I don't know that a required roster is a good way to facilitate a civil discussion. But that said, you should put the onus on the city. As I said before you got here, Commissioner, if a city official is hosting a meeting, then I have to report your name. Pass around the roster and send it to you. Or pass around the roster in the city official files. I want to speak to the point, though, about how the reporting is, because I have long thought that just saying planning department doesn't give very much information. I think that if the system were briefly characterized the nature of the meetings and which approvals you were working on, in effect, write a three-sentence paragraph, I think that's perfectly reasonable. And I don't think you have to, like you, my timesheets are the bane of my existence, I don't think you have to be typing every minute in order to do that. But I think it speaks to the reason why there should be public disclosure. I think the public does have a right to know what the nature of the meetings were. Every meeting, every official, I know I'm going to make mistakes.
Let me ask this question.